everyone, and welcome to the Ingenuity Systems Scientific Webinar, The Bioinformatician's Guide to Lung Cancer, Wnt7a Signaling and Beyond, with our guest speaker, Dr. Michael Edwards. My name is Michelle Zucca with Ingenuity Systems, and I will be your moderator for today's webinar. Over to you, Michael.
Thanks, Michelle. So I'd like to spend the next 40 minutes or so using my work in the lung cancer field to tell a story on how bioinformatics can be used to answer specific biological questions. And as part of that process, how bioinformatics software like Wnt7a Pathway Analysis, or IPA for short, aids and facilitates this work. So if I'm going to talk about the bioinformatic process, I should probably first define what bioinformatics is. And this is not an easy task, given that this is a new field. And even though this is my profession, I have never taken a class with the term bioinformatics in the title. When I tell my non-scientific friends and family that I'm a bioinformatician, their usual reaction is to ask if I'm available for children's parties. As far as my fellow scientists go, I could probably ask 10 of them for their definition of bioinformatics and get 10 different answers. So, in order to help me to find a suitable definition, I decided to consult the most trusted and the most utilized reference in science today, Wikipedia. And it gave this definition, and I'm not going to read this verbatim, but in summary, the definition says that bioinformatics is the method of collecting, storing, and analyzing data that is generated from just about any biological substance. This method uses a bunch of computer and mathematical skills to gain new knowledge from this data that can be used to design new drugs, always with a drug design. A very vague and uninformative definition, in my opinion. So my own personal opinion of bioinformatics goes like this, is that our ability to measure things about biological entities, tissues, diseases, etc., has exceeded the average scientist's ability to understand it all. As an example, we now have the technology to know the sequence of all 6 billion base pairs in the DNA of a single diploid human cell. And this number doesn't even touch the activity of the approximately 21,000 different human genes and their isoforms in the human genome, or the hundreds of thousands of different proteins that are transcribed from these genes. What is needed is a specialized area of science that can take all of this enormous amount of data and break it into useful bits that your average scientist can digest and use to inform their research. So how we break this data up is what I call kind of the art of bioinformatics analysis. As was suggested by the Wikipedia definition, we do use computers and mathematics in this process, but for my talk today, I'm going to focus on using bioinformatics software like IPA to identify biological connections in the data, and we're going to use these biological connections to make these bite-sized bits that will inform our research. Okay. So as I mentioned, I'm going to use my work in the lung cancer field as a framework to discuss bioinformatics. This is the work of my collaborator, Dr. Robert Wynn. He works on Wnt7a signaling as it relates to lung cancer, and he's doing some really amazing, innovative work, and I look forward to discussing his research with you all. So using this as the framework, as of for bioinformatics process, I'm going to discuss how you don't even need your own data, that you can go out there and find public data on your own. There's a mountain of just free data waiting for you to use. Also, as part of this process, I'm going to discuss how we use statistics to get a list of genes of interest related to what we're studying. Also, the statistics allows us to find overrepresented function and pathways that we might be able to target in our particular list of genes. Then I want to discuss briefly network construction. So this is going beyond what is known as far as the pathways go and kind of constructing your own interactomes. And then a final thing that I wanted to talk about, upstream regulators. And this is a new feature for IPA, and this is one I'm really excited about. It allows us to find these master regulators of these genes that affect the expression of many other genes. And so obviously you can imagine this would be important in any system that you're studying. And then at the very end, I'm just going to try to summarize what we've learned from Wnt7a signaling using bioinformatics. And just I would like to give you some kind of take-home things about bioinformatics in general as a science. So as I mentioned, my collaborator works on Wnt signaling, actually one very specific aspect of it. So the traditional canonical thinking of Wnt signaling, the canonical pathway, has a variety of Wnt ligands binding to its associated receptors, frizzled receptors on the outside of the membrane. This elicits a signaling cascade, which eventually results in the upregulation of beta catenin. This beta catenin then goes on to induce the expression of other genes and to elicit the Wnt signaling function. Now, in the cancer field, this signaling pathway, for the most part, is considered pro-oncogenic, or actually bad if you're trying to treat the tumor. That they have observed in many different cell types elevated beta catenin levels, and so there's actually been a movement to try to inhibit this pathway in certain cancers. Well, my collaborator works on a specific ligand. This is Wnt7a, and it binds its associated receptor, Frizzled-9. This, again, elicits a signaling pathway, which, again, does not involve beta-catenin, and it results in structural changes to the cell. And again, he believes that the Wnt7a is actually, instead of promoting tumors, it's a tumor suppressor pathway. And I'm going to give you the evidence of why he believes this. That if you look at normal lung, which is given here on the left here, this is a section which has been stained for Wnt7a, so this shows up in brown. You can see that Wnt7a is all over the place in normal lung. When you now, if you take this histology and this becomes cancerous, if you take this normal lung tissue becomes cancerous, given here on the right, this is an example of adenocarcinoma, you can see that there's no brown color, so Wnt7a disappears. And this is kind of similar what we see in all kinds of tumors where P53, an important cell cycle control, becomes mutated before the normal tissue can become cancerous. So Wnt7a is lost in human lung adenocarcinomas. And in fact, actually, they estimate 85% of all lung tumors lose Wnt7a. So that's interesting. So the obvious question would be, okay, these tumors lose Wnt7a. What happens when you actually reintroduce this signaling pathway back into these lung cancer cells? And some pretty amazing things happen, actually. Number one, their replication is slowed down tremendously. And then they actually start looking more like normal epithelial cells. Given on the top here is this lung cancer cell line, H2122, it lacks Wnt7a. It's been stained for extracellular markers, structural markers, given in the red and green. And you can see they're just kind of amorphic. They're just growing and not a very organized structure. But if you look down here, so this is the same cell line, and we have transcribed, or we've put back in Wnt7a with its associated receptor, Frizzled-9. And now you can see that more structure and order, that they're actually forming these balls, that they're almost starting to look like skin cells in a way. They're making the connections to their fellow epithelial neighbors. And so this is pretty amazing in that for most cancer therapies, it's concentrated on killing the cancer. And if anyone out there had a loved one go through chemotherapy, you can imagine the side effects that come with trying to just kill the cancer. Well, in this instance, we're actually taking these cancer cells and turning them back into normal. So we're really excited about this process, and we'd like to use this as a therapy, but in order to use something like this, you have to understand it at the molecular level. And so that was my question to my collaborator was, how does this happen on the, what does Wnt7a use? What's the signaling pathway? In bioinformatics, it's all about networks. And so I actually looked in the literature, and they've been looking at this for quite a while, since 2005, but they've really been about the only group that's really focused on this pathway, so not a whole lot has been known. Basically, my Rob Wynn gave me this kind of bare bones pathway that he thinks what's occurring in these cells, and that Wnt7a binds its associated receptor, Frizzled-9. Again, this causes a signaling pathway, phosphorylation signaling pathway, that might involve MEK5 and ERK5, they believe, which results in the upregulation of this gene called PPAR gamma. And it's now this PPAR gamma that it is is a gene that's been shown to be a beneficial in normal lung. And it induces a wide variety of genes, one of these being E-cadherin. This is a molecule important in those cell-to-cell connections that epithelial cells do. It induces important cell cycle inhibitors like P63, also signaling molecules like NF-kappa-B. And again, they do not believe that it involves beta-catenin. So this is what, if we hope to use this pathway as a potential therapy against lung cancer, we're going to have to understand it. And if we understand it, maybe we can manipulate it for our own uses. So this is how I thought bioinformatics could help my collaborator. But he did not have his own data. So what I was going to do is take advantage of the mountains of free data that are available. This is a screenshot of CHEO, the gene expression omnibus. And this is probably the most popular or most used place to deposit array data or data. And so this is the source that I'm going to use to investigate this signaling pathway. As of today, there are more than 30,000 different experiments that have been deposited in GEO or studies. So I'm hoping that I can find, and for most of you out there, I guarantee you'll find something related to what you're doing in this data set. So what data am I talking about? Obviously, I've been throwing that term around quite a bit. Well, for this talk, what I'm talking about is global gene expression or gene expression arrays. And what is that? And I know this is going to be reviewed for a lot of people, but I'm going to go through it anyway. So traditional biology dogma has, in order for the DNA in your nucleus to do anything, it has to make a copy of itself, a complementary copy. And we call this messenger RNA. And this messenger RNA goes into the cytosol to find ribosomes. And it's basically instructions to make proteins. And it's to transcribe proteins that do all the work in the cell, that these are the enzymes, the signaling molecules. So this is how the brains, you can think of it, are headquarters in your cell, send messages or emails to the factories in order to get anything done in the cell. Well, we have the ability to isolate this messenger RNA. We can isolate this messenger RNA, we can label it with a fluorescent tag, and then hybridize it to microarrays that have the complementary sequence of all potential genes in the human genome. And based on the fluorescence, the brighter, the more active that gene might be, the lower the brightness, the lower activity that gene would be. So we have the ability to measure all genes in the human genome at the same time. But again, this is just a snapshot. So you could probably imagine how this would help in biology. And this has really actually changed the entire field of science, that we can take a bunch of individuals who are normal, and then those individuals with a disease. And we can take samples, the mRNA from both of those, and determine what genes are different as far as on and off, higher or lower in the disease. We use statistics to do this, and we can generate a gene list of genes that are different between these two. And if we study these genes, the biology underlying these genes, we're going to get a better idea of how this disease arises and potential cures for it. Well, not all comparisons are static A versus B, disease versus normal. We can have continuous variables that we want to look at. So what do I mean there is that we don't have just one type of cancer, that we can have many different types. We can have tumor size that are variable. And so if I wanted to find genes that are important in growing a tumor, I might want to find genes that change or increase as my tumor increases. This is called a correlation. And the whole, and given here also, is genes that are correlated to an important chemotherapy agent, ponatinib. Basically, the theory behind this is that if two things vary at the same rate over the same samples, then they're probably connected processes, that either one controls the other or something's controlling both. But regardless of it, they're probably involved in a similar biological process. So we can not only do this to genes and biological variables, but we can do it to genes and genes itself, that if a gene behaves like another gene, they might be involved in the same process. And this is actually what I'm going to use to try to figure out what Wnt7a is doing in these lung cancer cells. So it's all kind of the theory of defining something based on its best friends and worst enemies, right? That over here on the left, I have two different genes. given here. This is a race that I pulled off of GEO. And the columns represent the relative gene activity. So the higher the columns, the more active that gene would be. The lower the bars, the lower the activity. And as you can see, these two genes in this study, these are two different genes, have a very similar pattern over all of these genes. We would call this positive correlation. So again, these two genes are probably interacting with each other to perform the same function. And this is useful information. This helps define both of these. Well, again, we can have the converse too, right? That we can have the opposite effect, that when this gene here is high in one sample, it's low in the other. And instead of maybe working together, this potential, one of these genes might be suppressing the other, and we would call this a negative correlation. And this also might be useful information. Again, we're using all of this information to help, I'm going to use all this information to help define what Wnt7a does. I'm going to find its best friends, and I'm going to find its enemies. Again, they've used this technique, other people have used this technique to great effect. This is one of the early array experiments. This is from 1998. Cho et al. Basically took yeast cells and synchronized them and let them go through two cycles of the cell cycle. And then they basically took gene expression at various points during that cell cycle and grouped these genes based on similar levels of expression. And what they found was is that genes that peaked at particular transition moments tended to be important in those transitions for the cell cycle. Not only were they able to find genes that they already knew were important, but genes that they didn't know that they were later able to validate important in these transitions. So it allowed them to find genes that they didn't know were important in the cell cycle. So if I'm going to find genes that are related to Wnt7a, I got to find a unique pattern for Wnt7a. So my first impulse was to search GEO for lung cancer studies. And you can do this here. It's a very user-friendly site. You can search using text searches. So I searched for lung cancer. And I forgot that that Wnt7a signaling, actually, remember I showed you that Wnt7a is lost in normal lung tumors. And obviously, I'm seeing the same thing in these array studies. If I want to find a unique pattern, I can't pick a skyline that only has one skyscraper. So I was really trying to find genes where I could see variable levels of expression. And I was kind of downtrodden until I came up with or identified this array study. This was done by a group on normal pure cell culture. So these are not cancerous cells. These were commercially bought cell cultures from five different cell types, coming from 30 different tissue sets on the human body. There were 61 samples here. And the interesting thing is that the platform they used for this array is actually non-existent anymore. And I wasn't able to find any type of manuscripts or papers that referenced this. So it was almost like a throwaway array study. But as you'll see, it was actually a really, really good array study. Obviously, if you're going to use somebody else's data, you have to make sure it's good. There's all kinds of quality control measurements we use to determine whether the data set is sound. One of these is actually visualizing the data. This is actually one of my favorite quality control or most utilized quality control measures. Here, basically what we do is we take the variability in the gene expression. We kind of summarize that, and we use that to plot these samples in three-dimensional space so that samples that are more like each other tend to be closer in three-dimensional space, and those that are more biologically distinct tend to be farther in three-dimensional space. And here we can see that the five cell types, which are colored here, seem to be grouping in the relative similar space. So I was fairly confident that this data set was going to be okay. This is the expression of Wnt7a in this study, and this is very interesting. As you can see, that Wnt7a is not expressed in any of the other cell types, the endothelial, fibroblasts, smooth muscle, and stromal. The only place where it's actually expressed is the epithelial cells, and there's three different types of epithelial cells here. And this is important. Remember, I discussed how we take these lung cancer cells, we put Wnt7a back, and it makes these cells kind of return to a normal epithelial cell. Well, these Wnt7a is exclusive to the epithelial cell, and this was very good information from my collaborator. Not only that was that potentially what we discover concerning lung cancer might have applications to other types of cancers that derive from epithelial cells, such as breast cancer, colon cancer, etc. This is another picture of Wnt7a signaling. Again, here are the three epithelial cell lines that I'm going to be using, renal, vaginal, and cervical, that demonstrate that Wnt7a signaling. So what I'm going to do is what I'm looking for are genes in this data set that replicate this pattern of expression. And if I study these genes that are related, that look like Wnt7a, I can figure out what Wnt7a, how it's doing what it's doing in these cells. So to find genes that look like Wnt7a, I just do simple statistics. I use a Pearson correlation, or this is linear correlation. And this is a pretty standard statistical test. You could actually do this in Microsoft Excel. We're getting a lot of genes that came up as correlated to Wnt7a. Given here on this blue line is basically zero correlation, and those genes on the right would be those that are positively correlated to Wnt7a, and the farther on the left, the more negatively correlated. And as you can see, the majority of these show a positive correlation to Wnt7a. Now, where do you draw the line? What genes do you actually look at? Well, it depends on which what function you would like to use this information for. And obviously I'm trying to reconstruct this signaling pathway for Wnt7a, so I want to be very specific on what genes I want to look at. So I took the top 300 transcripts, which correspond to an R value greater than 0.8. So these are these genes right here, these 300 genes out of approximately 20,000 that were measured on my array. So I'm going to probe or mine these genes for information on Wnt7a. So how am I going to mine these genes? Well, I'm going to use bioinformatic software, and my bioinformatic software of choice is IPA, or Ingenuity Pathway Analysis. I'm really happy with this bio. This program has been around for quite a bit. It's very user-friendly, and it's got a very deep database, and I'm very happy with it. So what's the principles behind this software? And I'm going to very briefly try to explain how all this bioinformatics stuff works. And it's actually not very difficult. It's odds that if I have a limited number of choices, what are the odds that I pick a certain amount of things with a limited number of draws? Given here is this pathway that many experts feel is important in lung cancer signaling. There are 40 genes in this pathway. So this might be a good pathway to determine whether this is in my 300 genes that are correlated to Wnt7a. So again, these 40 members, so I want to know if this pathway is overrepresented in these 300 genes that I picked. Well, these 40 members of this pathway are part of the 21,000 total human genes. And that, what are the odds if I get 300 draws from these 21,000 human genes, what are the odds that I get one of these? Well, it's probably pretty likely. Maybe half the time I do this, I get one of these genes. So I would say no, this pathway based on this result is probably not overrepresented. Now what if I get three genes? Maybe only 5% of the time I would expect to get this by random chance. So yeah, maybe this might be playing a role in my system, but I don't know. Now, if we look at seven genes, say if I draw seven genes in my 300 genes from this pathway, maybe the odds that I would get that by random chance are 1 in 5 million. Then I would say yes, I believe this system is playing a role in my 300 genes, because the probability of me getting all of these genes is very, very low. And that's honestly, that's the underlying principle for all bioinformatics software. Not only can you do this with pathways, but you can do it with genes. You know, anytime you have a limited number of genes associated with a particular biological condition, you can do this. We can do this for pathways. We can do this for functions like immune functions or cell signaling pathways, etc. Again, any contained biological unit works. And the really cool thing with a lot of this software now is that we can find these upstream regulators, using this method. Given here is that we know, based on the scientific literature, what genes target other genes, and we can compile lists of target genes. Given here is just an example of interleukin 1A. And so that, and it's showing 43 genes that are previously known to be associated with this molecule. And if these 43 genes, if I got these 43 genes in my 300 genes, I might say, yes, interleukin 1A, the targets or genes that known to interact with interleukin 1A are overrepresented in my genes of interest. And therefore, interleukin 1A is probably playing a role. And this is important, too, in that, you know, a lot of these genes or these proteins are cytokines. The things that affect transcription might come from distal places like hormones or growth factors. And so that you might not get to the cell that was actually producing that, but you can see its effect in the cell you're looking at. And not only that, but we can actually predict activity based on what we know, that all of the genes in the orange are known to, or interleukin 1 is known to induce or actually activate all the genes in the orange with the orange bars. And those genes in the blue, this interleukin 1A is known to inhibit. And based on this pattern, and based on the pattern of expression, if the majority of genes are inducing or being inhibited based on that pattern, we can predict, yes, we think this, we can give a confidence score to say we believe interleukin 1A is actually more active. And not only can we do this with genes, but we can do this with microRNAs, which can affect the expression of hundreds of genes at the same time, chemicals, and drugs. And these two are very important because this can allow us to potentially find something that we can make that can mimic whatever effects we want. So I kind of want to wake everybody up. I've been talking about bioinformatic theory and some of the underlying theory behind this. So basically what I want to get everybody's attention that we are going to take the theories that I talked about and apply those to the 300 genes that were correlated to Wnt7a. Okay, so the most overrepresented function, so this has the most target genes in our list of 300, was epidermal hyperplasia. And this is type of a pre-cancer condition in lung cancer. And that we would expect this, obviously. You know, Wnt7a has these dramatic effects on the growth of these tumors. So we'd expect a bunch of genes that are devoted to this. So we're actually confirming what we already know, which is good. But not only that, is now I have 13 genes that are associated with this potential biological function that I can now target. Okay, now as I said that based on the patterns of expression of my 300 genes, I can predict what functions or genes might be more active or inhibited. So the most activated function is epithelial differentiation. And this is kind of like, this is taking basically stem cells and turning them into epithelial cells, which is kind of the reverse of the tumor's genesis process. And we would expect this, obviously, and this confirms what we already know, that we're looking at probably a tumor suppressor pathway. And again, here are all the genes. There are 17 genes that are known to be associated with this function, and that 7 of these are known to increase this process. Therefore, I would say, this process is increased in the 300 genes that I'm looking at. Some of the inhibited functions is the proliferation of prostate cancer cell lines. Again, we would predict this based on the tumor suppressor properties of Wnt7a. Again, 9 genes are associated with this process, and 7 of these are known to decrease this. So therefore, we're given a confidence score of saying that this process is down in our 300 genes. Well, I've spent a lot of time talking about what we already know and what experts have put together, but you know, I kind of want to go as far as the Wnt7a. As I mentioned, we don't really know what's going on, so I want to figure out what is the signaling pathway Wnt7a is utilizing to do what it does. And so I use the IPA function, the network generation. Basically what this does is it takes a group of genes and finds if there's any relationship between them at all, either direct or indirect, whether they're in the same pathway or not. And so this is what I hope to utilize to try to put together what is Wnt7a signaling through to do what it does. And again, I remind you of the bare bones pathway that I was given beforehand. Not very informative, so I'm going to try to flesh this out and give him something that he could potentially go after and target. Again, this is a screenshot from IPA. This is the networks tab. And so what I'm going to show you is the top network, which got a score of 76. So the higher the score, the more significant that network is. And this is actually one of the highest scores I've ever seen. And I use IPA quite a bit. This is the network here. As you can see, when you're doing networking, you're looking for kind of hubs and spokes. You're looking for these hubs, things that are connecting with all kinds of things. And if you just look at this, I know it looks like a spider web, but you can kind of see things are starting to come out that might be kind of master regulators. And obviously, we're targeting something of this, some of these genes. One of the cool features is that now I can also overlay whatever I want onto this network. This can be functions, pathways. In this particular instance, which is obviously relative to what we're doing, I overlaid whether any of these genes had previously been used as a biomarker in any types of cancer. And not surprisingly, a great deal of these have been used as biomarkers. And also that the disappearance of these genes tends to signal a more severe type of cancer progression. Again, here's the network here. Remembering the bare bones, my collaborator knew about E-cadherin. What he didn't know is also we're all getting a fellow family member. P-cadherin is also showing up. This was information that he did not know. We're getting 6 cytokeratins. These are important in the structure of the epithelial cell. And then we're getting a lot of these genes that are associated with desmosomes. These are these attachments that I talked about, where these epithelials make their own attachments. And as you can see, remember I told you Wnt7a had to do something with structure, and we saw that in the pictures that I showed you. But you can see a lot of the action is actually within the plasma membrane here. And now we can take this and we can actually put this in the plasma membrane, superimpose this on the structures. So here's a picture of an attachment plaque in these epithelial cells. This is a desmosome. Again, remember, E-cadherin and P-cadherin show up. These are these green things that facilitate the attachment with these cells. We get 6 keratin molecules. These make the connection to the cell membrane and to structural elements within the cell. And then we have these attachment plaques and the desmosomes. And we're getting a bunch of genes that are coming here. So now I've put together this network. Now we're actually moved on to structures that we can actually target. And this is interesting, too, is that, we think of cancer genetics involving, the cell cycle. But, at least with this Wnt7a, a lot of this signaling pathway is centered on the outside of the cell. I was talking to my collaborator. It was almost like you're putting a leash around the cancer and it becomes tame. That when you reintroduce Wnt7a into these cancer cells and forces them to make these connections, it tethers them in place. And as they get tethered, they figure out that they're epithelial cells and they start to reverting back. And again, obviously I mentioned the upstream regulators. So basically what we're doing is we're looking for overrepresented targets of particular genes, chemicals, and drugs. And I should have mentioned too is I believe the drug and microarray target analysis is only in the beta version, and that might be coming in the newer version of IPA. So some of the things that are activated, these are the genes in the orange. This is TGF-beta-1, this growth factor. My collaborator had no idea that this might be playing a role. Certain important cell cycle inhibitors, I mentioned P63, but P53 targets are showing up. As far as those that are inhibited, we've got microRNAs coming up. And I mentioned that we didn't believe beta-catenin was involved, but we're actually seeing a fellow family member, alpha-catenin, being actually inhibited, or the genes that are correlate to Wnt7a show an inhibited pattern for alpha-catenin. And this is what I thought was very interesting. So the most activated and inhibited compounds in this list are actually chemicals. The most inhibited chemical is this chemical called TCDD. and actually has a very long chemical name, but it is the chief carcinogen in the herbicide Agent Orange. And if you remember, during the Vietnam War, people that were exposed to this herbicide had elevated instances of cancer. So this is a mean bad carcinogen that typically inhibits at least 11 of the genes that look like Wnt7a. And now, if you look at the most activated gene, it's this chemical called decitabine. And this is a very interesting chemical. Decitabine also goes by the brand name Decogen. It's a hypomethylating agent, which means it unsilences genes. They've been using this chemical on myelodysplastic syndromes. These are blood disorders. What they found is in this process that it also used in they got good results using this on blood cancers. And they believe it works that way because it activates particular tumor suppressor genes. Obviously, genes that look like Wnt7a or might be acting with Wnt7a. And again, they are now using this as a chemotherapy agent and having very good success on particular types of cancer, acute myeloid leukemia, ovarian cancer, breast cancer. And at least, as far as I know, at least my researches go, they have not used this on lung cancer. So now we have a potential a treatment that we could use on some of these lung cancer cell lines that might have lost Wnt7a. Okay, so to sum it up, what did we learn about Wnt7a using bioinformatics? Well, we learned that Wnt7a expression is exclusive to epithelial cells and that it is missing in the lung tumor tissue. And we learned that by surveying the public data. And I didn't even have to analyze the data in order to figure this out. We also learned that cellular functions are associated with cell growth and cell adhesion, are overrepresented in genes that are correlated to Wnt7a, and we use statistics in the function pathway analysis to determine this. And again, not only are we getting pathways and functions that are coming out, but we're giving actual genes or targets for those functions, and then we can potentially manipulate. And then lastly, we provided a list of targets and compounds to test for their involvement in Wnt7a signaling. So just to review, we didn't know anything about Wnt7a signaling. We used public data that wasn't even lung cells to find genes that are correlated to Wnt7a. And analyzing those genes that look like Wnt7a, we were then able to construct networks that probably represent the real, what Wnt7a is doing in these cells, number one. And number two, we actually now have a drug that we can use that might replicate the function of Wnt7a. And again, this was the network and upstream regulator analysis. So what I want to take you home, as far as just bioinformatics in general, that public data is free and plentiful. There are mountains and mountains of it out there. The gene expression omnibus, GEO, the one I gave, is just one example. There's other databases out there. Just tons and tons of data. Bioinformatics can be used to probe this resource to identify molecules, drugs, genes, pathways, etc. that might be important in your system. And that the bioinformatic tools to probe this information, like IPA, are becoming more functional and more intelligent. And they're absolutely becoming more user-friendly. This is a powerful tool. And the only reason I was able to give you the biology behind all this is that, you know, I work with my collaborator and I go to his lab meetings. But this is important, too, that if you're doing research, it's important that you're able to analyze the data yourself. And I think these types of tools allow you to do that. And this is the key one here is that the amount of data to probe will increase exponentially in the next 10 years. I do a lot of sequence data and it's just coming, it's like a big waterfall. I see the tsunami coming. There's going to be tons and tons of data to look at. I'd like to thank a few people. Obviously, Robert Wynn, my collaborator and his group, just one of the best people to work with. Just an excellent group, excellent guy, very smart. I appreciate all their work. I'd also like to thank my division head, Mark Geraci, who's given me the freedom to pursue research like this. And definitely I want to thank that throwaway array set that I used. This is the geo number here. You could actually find it and use it yourself if you'd like. And also I'd want to give a shout out to the bioinformatics core that I'm associated with here at University of Colorado, Denver. You can find it at this website, and we do analysis like this. Also, we've actually more been specializing in doing high-definition sequencing. So we're available for all your needs. And I want to thank you. Thank you very much.